Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. This is Shariq Irfan, your brother from Detroit, Michigan. I would like to, officially welcome you to the ICNA National Symposium. The theme for today is Indeed, I Am Near. That is the theme, and inshallah, we're going to have a packed seminar. So the next speaker I have is Dr. Altaf Husain. Dr. Altaf Husain serves as the Vice President of Yaqeen Institute and also the Associate Professor at Howard University. He specializes in community organizing and social welfare policy. He's a very well-known and face in our ICNA community. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Altaf Husain, please.
Thank you so much. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalatu wassalam ala ashrafil anbiya wal mursaleen Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi ashabihi ajma'in. My dear respected brothers and sisters, how exciting it would have been to obviously see you in person this weekend. My own children are so used to the conventions and conferences on Thursday night. They were talking about, you know, tonight we would have been packing up and getting ready to, you know, to go to the ICNA convention. Thankfully, this year it was going to be in DC, so it would have been just a short drive, you know, for them, for us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a different plan, and we go with that plan. I want to express my deepest gratitude to the leadership of ICNA, beginning with, the vision that they had to immediately make alternate plans for us, all of us, to enjoy this convention in an online symposium. May Allah bless them, the leadership and their families, all of the ICNA staff, and indeed the volunteers. As I begin my topic on Don't Just Survive, Thrive, I do also want to remind you that ICNA is a nonprofit organization, and its survival and its thriving is directly connected in terms of programs and services to how much you and I are able to donate and to support. So throughout my lecture and throughout this, you'll see a link on your screen there. It'll icna.org/donate. We really hope that your family will take a minute to donate. We made the cost of registration for the symposium, inshallah, very accessible at $20 for the entire family to watch. But I'm hoping you'll take a minute and say, you know, there's five of us watching, or in the case of, let me call him out, in the case, because he posted about this, Dr. Mohsin Ansari, that three generations are watching. So we're expecting, you know, inshallah, that he and others will donate, you know, per individual, let's say, as a registration, as a donation, even though the actual registration fee is only $20. So icna.org/donate, and I'll remind you again before I finish speaking. So to the topic itself, don't thrive, don't survive, don't just survive, thrive. I want to, you know, first spend a little bit of time on survival. The interesting thing is, typically we say this phrase, you know, don't just survive, thrive. And we have a lot of assumptions in our mind. I want to really pause to acknowledge that there are many, many people here in America and overseas who literally are trying to survive. They're just trying to survive. Job losses, if they were prior to this if they were experiencing food insecurity, experiencing hunger and homelessness, being underemployed or unemployed, if they were uninsured or underinsured before this pandemic even, you know, hit us, those situations didn't change, and in fact they might have even gotten worse. So we're so, you know, happy that there are organizations such as ICNA Relief and Helping Hand, both domestically and internationally, who are saying that we will not abandon our neighbors, regardless of their background, regardless of whatever religion or, you know, lack of religion or anything we know about them, just to help them. So I wanted to pause there about the survival, because it may not be that we just assume that everyone is able to just get past the surviving into thinking about thriving. So those challenges are there, and we do need to think about what we can do as a community. The second part of that is, consider it a luxury. If you were immediately able to go past thinking about survival into what all of us did, and Allah knows, you know, what is basically wrong in terms of our conduct, but we were, you know, spending so much time engaging within the first few days of the shelter in place, you know, debates on WhatsApp, you know, such and such masjid is staying open, such and such, you know, masjid is staying closed, such and the Jummah. And then we were debating as if we were the people who are scholars. We were debating about, you know, conspiracy theories, whether, you know, who started the virus, where did it come from, all kinds of things. While it may be helpful for a little bit to think about those things, really it's a luxury, because what everybody else is worried about, the people I mentioned now who are trying to survive, maybe if that's not what you're worried about, use that time wisely. And we'll now talk, inshallah, about going past just surviving into thriving. Surviving also included, and this was something a part of our as Muslims, at the individual level and at the family level, getting through the routine, getting through the day, getting through, you know, work, getting through school and college, getting through our family commitments, you know, running around with the kids' activities, soccer practice, this practice, that practice, you know, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, young Muslims, dropping them off here, there. All of those things were part of just survival, literally. Some of it was thriving because we would stop and, you know, reflect on what we were doing, but most of it had to do with survival. It's a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who says in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْإِنسَ وَالْجِنَّ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, that we have not created human beings and the jinn except to worship us, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So survival is our way of basically getting through the day. But the real thriving should be happening in a way that we at the individual level, at the family level, are beginning to see what are the opportunities for improvement? What are the real opportunities for me to improve? How can I actually take back control over some of the time that I used to, you know, spend perhaps commuting, right? If you live in a metropolitan area, sometimes the commute just to go back and forth from work is a half an hour, 45 minutes, in my case in Washington, D.C., to get to Howard University is maybe an hour sometimes, hour and 15 minutes in a terrible traffic, hour and a half. All of that's gone. No commuting anywhere. How am I using that time? Have I replaced that time with something else just to keep me busy? Or am I actually using it to focus on my life and my lifestyle? So what are some things we can do in terms of that thriving? The beautiful thing is that the way this fell, the way the pandemic started, it happened in the Rajab, a blessed month. And then, subhanAllah, we are now in Shaban. We are just literally less than 2 weeks, approximately 2 weeks. So first we make the dua, Allahumma barik lana fi Shaban. Oh Allah, give us the blessings of Shaban. And then Allahumma balighna Ramadan. Oh Allah, help us indeed to witness and to be a part of Ramadan. Finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala slowed down all of life so that we could approach Ramadan in a very peaceful, organized, prepared way. Four of the five pillars of our religion, talk about thriving, four out of the five pillars of our religion, we can literally continue to practice without any interruptions. I'm hoping at the individual and family level, you are not just doing salah as survival, that you're actually doing salah as thriving. What does that mean? Maybe some of the children who are of age now and able to lead the salah in your homes, the young, you know, Muslims, the young men, maybe they can now, subhanAllah, practice leading prayer. Maybe the younger children can practice doing the adhan and the iqamah. Maybe they can help to get ready and prepare, and maybe they are the ones who walk around and get everyone out of their Zoom meetings and school routines and everything else and get to prayer. Maybe after the prayer, instead of running, we used to do the same thing. We used to pray Maghrib and run to a Boy Scout meeting, or pray Maghrib and run to drop off someone from practice or pick up someone from practice. Adhkar. Thriving will be adhkar. Thriving will be stopping with the family and doing tasbih, the Ayatul Kursi, right? Maybe having a reflection of a Quranic verse or a hadith. What is going to change? What is going to change? There's nowhere to rush to. So might as well do the prayer part of it. Of course, the sadaqah and the zakah, alhamdulillah, ICNA.org/donate. You can actually not leave your home to be able to help others. The amazing services that ICNA, you know, provides in terms of dawah and relief and all of the other things. The national organization is the mothership. It deserves our support. But you don't have to leave home to do that. You can go online, pick up the phone, make phone calls, or go online and donate. The zakah, maybe you're thinking of calculating it and paying it in Ramadan. If you know the approximate amount, why not make the pledge in Shaban and get the blessings and then pay it in Ramadan, inshallah. All of these things, we don't have to leave home. We can actually improve and thrive right here where we are. So brothers and sisters, as I start to, you know, wrap up my time, I want to begin where I emphasize about survival. We are all just surviving. That's how I feel. A few among us, and maybe because of their dua and their efforts, we were all saved from an even worse, you know, trial. A few among us were spending more time connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But maybe it's time to use this pandemic, this shelter in place, this lockdown, shutdown, whatever it's being called in your area, to return to the habits that we can form and inshallah thrive. Maybe that cycle of the family praying together, maybe the month of Shaban when it's remaining, the Monday fasting, the Thursday fasting as a family, preparing because we're going to be at home. Ramadan, for all intents and purposes, will be at home. So if we can start to fine-tune that routine now with suhoor as a family, everybody has a role to play, so no one family member is burdened in the preparation of that suhoor. Maybe in terms of the iftar, sitting together. We know the social aspects keep us really strong in meeting people, interacting with them, being able to, you know, to really exchange how our day has been going and things that Dr. Madiha talked about. But we're not going to be able to have that. Some of that will happen online, but we're not going to be able to have that. So the family bonds can actually not get stronger. And I'm the first to talk about this because in Ramadan, just with all of the different demands, we were planning literally, all of us, several of us who are in the, you know, in this arena of helping and serving the community, we would have been out of our homes on a Thursday night, on a Friday night, on a Saturday night, on a Sunday night, perhaps sometimes traveling outside of our towns, perhaps flying somewhere, taking the train somewhere. And that time would not have been with the family. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said to us, this is your time. Calm everything down. Start to really get closer to the Quran. Start to really get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the individual level, at the family level. And inshallah, if we can come out of this thriving, one of the ways we know, because the companions, you know, and the Prophet used to talk about this, that if you can sustain the beautiful habits you developed in Ramadan, outside of Ramadan. Similarly, if you can sustain the habits we're building now in Shaban with a closer knit, you know, a tight knit family, right? I know, as Dr. Madiha mentioned, there's other challenges with the family. You're not going to resolve every issue during this pandemic. So don't try to. But at least focus on that which is in your reach. Dua, Salah, Quran, fasting, right? All of these things are within our reach. So brothers and sisters, don't just survive. That's for those of us who are not having to worry about putting food on the table, shelter for the family, and physical and emotional and mental health safety. Things like that are worrying many of our neighbors, fellow Americans, and Muslims, and other people here and abroad. So make dua, lots of dua, that we are being spared some of that difficulty of just trying to survive. But then, for ourselves, go beyond and make dua, O Allah, help us indeed to thrive in this time so that we can develop and sustain those habits as we go forward. Brothers and sisters, I'm going to close now by reminding you again that the great work that ICNA is doing, it's really something phenomenal. Back in 1968, over 52 years ago, the founders had a vision that not only would they be staying in America and developing, you know, and having families and developing institutions and communities, but that they would actually be at the forefront of spreading the message of Islam in an unprincipled, in a principled, uncompromising way. We owe it to sustain that vision. We owe it to donate. ICNA.org, ICNA.org/donate. That's the link, inshallah. And as I turn it back over to Brother Sharik, I will come back for the Q&A, inshallah. But definitely, I want you to think about what you're benefiting, how much benefit is coming at home. Even my own mother, mashallah, who's a very big fan of ICNA and the sisters wing, is at home watching this. And she's not just watching it. I know Brother Sharik mentioned popcorn. She's not a fan of popcorn. But if you wanted to do this, have the children have some notebooks with them for the sessions on young Muslims. Yourselves, myself, let's have a notebook and take some notes about things that are being shared with us by the scholars who came before me and those who will speak after me. And I will turn it back over to Brother Sharik. Don't forget to donate ICNA.org/donate. Thank you.
So jazakallah khair, Dr. Altaf, for the amazing reminders and some practical tips that you shared with us. That I'd like to remind before I sign off and hand over is alhamdulillah, that even though the convention that we all miss and love is not able to go on, this work never stops. That's what I wanted to kind of emphasize on, that alhamdulillah we have the symposium, we have different departments and wings of ICNA proactively out there on the front lines taking care of the community in need. So I would really encourage and urge all of you to take some time and donate at www.icna.org/donate. So jazakallahu khair for your time.